Calabarzon is a bustling tourist destination for foreign visitors wanting quick trips to and from Manila. How then does the tourism industry remarket Calabarzon as a place to head to following Taal's disruption? With us now for more on our weekly Outside Looking In is Aileen Clemente, the president and chairman of Raja Travel Corporation. She is one of the authors of the Arrancada Policy Brief on Tourism at the American Chamber of Commerce of the Philippines. Good to have you back on, Aileen. Welcome
Hello.
To the program.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, you know, I was just looking at the policy brief. It started all the way from 2010, and it was just a massive 470 pages. I didn't go through all that, but I did understand that it was coming from a low base, and it was to understand that the tourism sector is one of the big winner sectors, one of the big seven. Has it lived up to its name, and what contributions has it had on the economy?
Well, it's been moving up. I think it's the third or the fourth largest contributor to our economy at present, and it's along the lines of the growth that is expected around the world. So we are doing good. Plus, with the new Tourism Act then, that propelled us to organize it into what it should be today. So we're still halfway there, but at least it got its feet on the ground.
So feet on the ground would mean an annual growth rate of 10%
around
each
year.
So are we then expecting 8 million international tourists to round out 2019? Is that where we're going to see in the data when the Department of Tourism releases it?
I would like to think so, but again, I would hope that we are on a different statistic that we're looking at instead of just looking at that, because that is more a concern for competitiveness level across ASEAN more than what should be our growth based on what we can handle in the Philippines.
Okay, so what exactly does that mean? Because what we can handle depends on the kind of tourism infrastructure we've got.
Correct.
So what are the other factors that come into play?
So, for example, we are an archipelago. Getting to and from each destination requires flights. So, of course, your airport should be able to handle the growth that we would want to see. But at the same time, each island should be able to have its own carrying capacity, so to speak, based on not just density, but also in terms of waste management, water supply, and all these other things that should contribute so that we are not displacing the locals that are living in each area.
Well, there are displacements now going on, and it's beyond that ideal ecosystem for tourism with the Taal volcano's disruption. Mm-hmm. It's unavoidable, but it is causing disruptions to the tourism industry right well within Calabarzon. It's one of the more bustling tourism sites in the country, in the northern part of the Philippines.
So, yes, there's that disruption right now, but hopefully it comes back up. So the world is looking at is how well do we bounce back? What is our readiness state? How are the other feeder locations or the nearby locations going to absorb this hit from this area? But after that, the question is, how well do we bounce back immediately after? What is our resiliency?
What is our resiliency then? I mean, what we're seeing right now, I mean, we don't even know if it's going to get any worse and if tourists are going to go back when there is that danger. How do we bounce back? And how do we remarket to the foreign tourists that it's okay to go into a place where it's near an active volcano?
Well, that's why there's also different types of tourism. There's what you call the leisure tourism, which I doubt that we will have in the near future, immediately thereafter. But you can also start your CSR tourism, meaning how can people help at this point in time? So you're still bringing them in to help out. Or maybe research tourism is another one where you have a unique activity happening in the area. So how do you bring them in? Where do you take them and so on? So it's a minor shift in the meantime that your other main type of tourists are not coming in.
So net, what impact would it have on tourism revivals? Do you think it will merely pivot that to other destinations in the Philippines, or is that going to keep foreigners away in the meantime?
I doubt that it will keep the foreigners away. We have so many things to offer in the Philippines. The thing is, they would have maybe wanted to see the heritage and culture of that area, but now they will be able to see the other heritage and culture of another area instead. But we have so many things to offer, that's why they would always say that it doesn't really affect the tourism in general in the Philippines.
Yeah, but for those who have set up weddings, I mean, that requires a lot of preparation. Mm-hmm. The reason why they're there, it's historical, it's cultural. Mm-hmm. Would it create a big impact for the MICE industry?
Again, we can always move them around. It will be painful for those who have done their preparations already, but it doesn't mean it's not doable to move them elsewhere. It's just a little bit more painful.
So is the tourism industry, of which you're involved in, already mm-hmm. doing that, educating the people on how to repivot and reschedule their plans away from Taal?
Well, at this point in time, probably not yet for those who are in the immediate area, because their main concern right now would be the dangers of the area and putting the news out there of what they can do if they are not going into that area. Where can they go? What else can they do? So it's more of, where are you sending them now because they cannot go to this area? Then after that, maybe then they can schedule them at a later time or move them somewhere else faster.
Longer term, we're talking sustainable tourism.
Yes.
I mean, that policy brief in 10 years has mm-hmm. evolved into including two aspects, sustainability yes. as mm-hmm. well as the ability to travel wherever you want mm-hmm. and seamless travel, in fact, is the operative phrase. Do you think it'll be easier for Calabarzon to bounce back if and when the tourism industry gets together and rebuilds according to sustainability mm-hmm. and seamless travel?
Yes, definitely. This framework is actually there not just for places that are already hit, but places in preparation for what they may be hit with. So to be prepared is very important. So again, are you prepared for anything that you need to be resilient for? Are we catching where our carrying capacity should be? Are we prepared in terms of moving into a more digital mode where you are not wasting our resources, paper, and so on? Even in the simplest processes that we have, like data gathering for how many tourists go to a certain location.
Was the tourism industry ready for what's happening now in Taal?
It's ready in some aspects, but not totally in all. So in terms of the national disaster management, that was done quite well, considering the shortness of time that it took. That was really very good. Now, in terms of preparedness, have we protected our assets, the heritage sites? Where are we there? We're not really taking care of them right now, really the way they should be. So these are the things that can be improved a little bit more.
I'm looking back on Pinatubo mm-hmm. because that could have been an example, a lesson to learn from in 1991. Mm-hmm. It's already rebuilt the area. It's got New Clark City mm-hmm. Touted to be the next hub to decongest Metro Manila. What can we take from Pinatubo and take to Taal in the rebuilding?
Mm-hmm. Well, right now, again, it's the preparedness has been done. So that was a lesson learned and where we were able to do a little bit more. Where we are still not working a lot on is the heritage. Now, the second one is the zoning. Has Clark done its zoning better? So are we able to do that better also with the Calabarzon area that was hit? So these are very practical and most important parts of tourism that has to be done.
Let me pick up on digital, because that's really interesting. Everyone's going digital, but what does it mean for sustainable tourism in the way of creating policies and programs mm-hmm. that would benefit and cascade to more sustainable tourism?
Okay. Of course, you have those that are very much visible in terms of sustainability, in terms of the environment, the zoning, and so on. But again, let's talk about the small processes that people tend to neglect. Like even just data gathering of how many people go into the site. They still write it down in a logbook and the data doesn't get transposed and moved fast enough for the decision makers to decide on what to do with the site. Not even electronic payments are accepted in some of these sites. So to do some consolidation work and to work together, which is very important, is one of the things that can be done already with the digital sustainability.
Beyond this infrastructure issue, I mean, we still got to get the digitalization idea together, but it appears to us that it's a mindset change.
Yes.
That people have to rethink that tourism is not just about economic growth, mm-hmm. but promoting the environment mm-hmm. and helping culture and preserve culture.
Yes.
How do we get around to that?
Well, actually, it's already spelled in the policy brief on who needs to do what. It's just a matter of doing the actual meetings and putting the right agenda together so that it can be done. So everything actually has been laid down, and we have already also noted which parts have been done and which ones need to still be done.
So which ones? And so, what is the chamber's, what are the chamber's efforts in getting it done?
Well, the first is writing the updated brief. And then the second is, we already wrote down the things that need to be working together, such as what is the relationship of the airport, the sites, the different infrastructure, how do you move mobility more in a better manner instead of just waiting for maps to be printed and so on. How can you do it digitally that even the scheduling of transport is more together and not just separated out, and you have to look for all of these different information in different parts.
It sounds like a lot of work and collaboration needed. You're in the travel industry. You're one of the pillars as boss of Raja Tours. I know that you've evolved your company from mere travel company and into a travel corporation dealing with knowledge. What are you now doing to help with the efforts?
Well, one of the things that we're actually doing is making sure that we have the right partners, because people are doing things on their own. And the thing is, we are trying to put them all together so that it will be more powerful at the end, because they're all working together. And it's really just that small piece of the pie that nobody's taking care of. So we thought that we would do it.